Hello, Rebecca. It's so nice to have you today with us. Thank you. How are you doing?
I'm great. I'm excited to be here today. I'm looking forward to our conversation. Thank you for having me.
Oh, thank you, Rebecca. It's such an honor. And I know that some people who listen to us on the summit, they know you already, some of the speakers. And I'm so happy to introduce you to all the other communities. And some people will be able to meet you in English, and then it's also translated in French. And I look forward to see the people who'd like to connect with you after the event, because I know this is really powerful for them to hear about you and to learn about your purpose. So thank you, Rebecca, again.
Thank you.
And I remember the thing before I say a little thing about you is that you are the one who always starts your interviews, radio shows by breathing. So let's breathe.
I love that.
Yeah. This is thanks for you. And that we can also interact with our people, on the summit. I will say a little things about you because the best thing would be for the people to hear from you, your purpose. So let me introduce you, Rebecca. Mm-hmm. So you are the founder and owner of your purpose-driven practice. You are also the creator of a women's empowerment conference events that is also as TV shows and that is released on 3 international TV networks. You're also the creator of a speaker talent search, which is so amazing one. This is the way we met each other back in 2017.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And we can speak about that. And also you are international best-selling author multiple times with anthologies and books by our own. And you're also the producer and creator of Empowering Women, Transforming Lives. Sorry if I do spell it this way. Empowering Women, Transforming Lives. This is a popular radio show which is released on multiple channels and networks around the world. Welcome, Rebecca.
Thank you. Honored to be here. Excited to have our conversation today. And I am so excited for your beautiful summit and all that you're bringing to everybody that's tuning in. It is so powerful, an amazing lineup of people, and you're holding space in such an incredible way for all of us. So thank you.
Yes, thank you, Rebecca. We know that your story of success does also include Empowered Connections TV. This is an international TV channel, number one most watched channel within 6 months of its launch on Voice America TV network. How is that?
You know, that was part of the journey in saying yes. And what I've discovered is when we say yes and we don't worry so much about how, but we step forward, we're in action, things come together in an amazing way. So that took a group of people, a team leaning in and trust that we were on the right path to bring positive transformational programming to the world. And they leaned in and the world received it powerfully.
Yeah. And you saying that, we know that you have a promotional reach now of over 10 million people. And you committed to help people to, you know, become a bright spot and to step into their brilliance. These are also book names that you co-created and that you indicated for people that I had the chance to contribute with inside with a chapter. And so my first question for you, is there any specific event, something that led you to step into this purpose yourself?
You know, it really goes back to my childhood, this purpose. And I think sometimes our purposes do. We just head in a direction on our path. But for me, I had a very unhealthy childhood. It wasn't safe. And when I called up for help, it wasn't believed. And I was always put back in the environment and it became more and more severe. And in that, I decided as a little girl that I didn't matter. I'm not okay. It's my fault. I'm unlovable. That it is absolutely not safe to be seen or heard. So I sought to be invisible, to stay below the radar, to survive. And eventually the truth came out and I was rescued, for which I'm very, very grateful. And I got to go on a healing journey. And what I discovered is those truths that I had believed were not true at all. They were lies. I discovered that I was beautifully and wonderfully made, that I mattered, that I was lovable, that it is, in fact, safe to be seen and heard. But that was the hardest part of my journey. It was so ingrained to be invisible, to smile really big and act like everything was okay when it was not, to be invisible even in the public eye. We can wear a certain persona, show up a certain way, make sure everyone knows the credentials after our name. Like, there's different ways we can hide in the public eye. And so I did that too. And on my journey, where things shifted powerfully for me, I was in finance. So I worked in a financial field. I had been in that industry for many, many years, probably 12 years at that point, had worked for large companies, Fortune 500 companies, and loved empowering people around money. It was very meaningful to me, and even built my own practice and my own business, which had its own learning curve in the process. But I was at this point where my business was finally where I wanted to be, sweat, blood, and tears to get it there, to grow, to learn. And I could see my path. I was about to get married. I was engaged to a wonderful man. Like, I could just see how life was going to be. And I was excited by it.
Oh, are you saying that you saw your life before it would happen?
Oh, this is at that moment, just kind of looking ahead. Yes. I was planning out getting married. I was planning out being a financial advisor, which was so much my identity, and all of these things that we were going to build together. I could just kind of see that path. And that's when God started tapping me on my shoulder. And when he whispered into my heart and spirit is, Rebecca, it's time. And I thought, time? Time for what? It's time for you. It's time for you to tell your story. And I thought, Oh no. That's not what financial advisors do. We don't talk about that. My story is uncomfortable. I don't want to share that. I don't want to go back there. I don't want to. I'm not a speaker. I'm a financial advisor. This is what I do. This is who I am. 9 months, he kept coming back to me and saying, it's time for you, prompting, poking. And then started to play tapes in my head, which I really didn't think was fair, of my healing journey. And I discovered God keeps really good records.
Really?
So, yes. So on that journey, as he's playing the video in my mind of what happened, and he shows some of those moments that were so key on the journey for me. And it was a conversations I'd have with him. I'd say, okay, God, here's the deal. I will do this mean, hard, horrible thing you're asking me to do of tell my story or stand in this space or tell the truth or take this stand. I will do this thing that is so scary for me if it can make a difference for another little girl. If the stand I take today will make their path easier, I will face my fear and I will take this stand and I would do it. And that would give me the courage. Because I didn't care enough about myself at that time to do it for me, but I could find the courage to do it for another. And wow, I would take that stand.
Goosebumps. It's so powerful what you share. Thank you so much.
Absolutely. And each step along the way, those big moments where I had to take a stand in some way, we'd have that same conversation. And so here he was coming again, asking me to take the stand for another, to share my story. And I was terrified. I was scared. I didn't want to. I actually gave him a list of other people who were much more qualified than I to do this thing. I did. And he set it to the side and kept coming back. And all the reasons why I shouldn't have to. I've suffered enough. I don't know how. Who am I? But also deep inside, there was a quickening of my spirit. There was this maybe it could make a difference. Maybe it could touch another and make their path better. Maybe it could. And there was that hope that would come forth. And so finally, 9 months crying on my knees, I said, okay, God, I will do this mean, hard, horrible, scary thing you're asking me to do, to tell my story, if I don't have to speak to more than 50 people at a time. I don't want to be recorded. Nothing with television, no books, no radio, no interviews. I don't know what to say, so you're going to have to give me that. I don't know what offers are, so however that's supposed to happen, you're in charge of that. And you just bring the people, let's go. And silence. And then he came back to me and he said, I think you misunderstood the question. Because I'm like, God, I said, yes, what's the deal? And he goes, it's yes or no, period. Will no you go condition. Where I call you to go? No, there's no condition. There's no boundaries. Will you go where I call you to go? Share what I call you to share or not? It is your choice. Choose. And I could feel to the very depth of my being, if I said yes to this, that path I had saw was no longer the path I would be on. I was no longer in charge. Not that I ever truly was, but I felt like I was in charge to some extent.
Oh, I see. Yeah.
And I felt safe to some extent and in control. And that was something that I so wanted, to be in control and safe and protected. And to release all of that, to not know where it goes, to not have the plan I had built, was difficult to let go. But it was freeing at the same time. And all those things I was saying, I don't want this, I'm afraid of that, no one was asking me to do any of those things. They were just the scariest things I could think of to say no, to try to protect myself, try to control. That was a big thing for me.
Yeah,
to control.
You can understand that.
Yeah. And so finally, I said yes. I said, okay, God, I release all. I'm in. And within a few months, I was on stage in front of 300 people. It was live streamed. You can just start checking things off the list. And I had 2 book deals in the works that later were released, and one became a number one international bestseller. I had 2 radio interviews lined up, a TV interview on cable TV that I just didn't even know how that happened. I felt tricked into that one. And stepping on stage, and I remember it was overwhelming, like all of that at once. And it was almost in spite of myself, you know, it just, you know, when we say yes, and there's a willingness, things start to line up. And that's what happened. And I remember feeling overwhelmed and looking out at the audience. And I looked at how I could leave the stage if I needed to, and walk off gracefully, smoothly, and quickly, and leave if I needed to keep myself safe. And I gave myself permission to do that, and something shifted in me.
I love that, to give yourself permission to protect yourself if it was needed. And then it helped you to go on stage.
It did. And I knew there was someone in the audience, there was one person in the audience that needed what I had to say. And so I took a breath, and that was enough. And I no longer had to be there. I was choosing to be there. And every minute that I was on that stage sharing, and I stepped on, and I was messy. I was imperfect. I cried. It was 7 minutes to 10 minutes, but it felt longer. But I shared from the very center of my heart. because I knew there was something in there needed that can make a difference. And I don't remember exactly what I said. I was a bit out of my body and got off the stage, and I got a standing ovation that I never saw because I was still so in that.
In between state.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And later when I got off the stage, there were a lineup of men and women. And one by one, they would come up to me and say, "Rebecca, I was the one. Thank you for sharing."
Oh, wow.
So either I said that sometime in the presentation or it was conveyed. And then the next person said it, and the next person. And to me, the line looked endless. I'm sure it wasn't, but it looked that way to me. And I couldn't believe person after person, and they were impacted. And then they and they were the one and the one and the one, like it was that personal of a connection. And then it started to shift and they started to say, "Rebecca, I could tell you were scared." So apparently that was clear. And they said, "But you cared enough about me anyway to share. Thank you. That gives me courage to do this." And they would tell me what they were going to do as a result of what was spoken to them that day in their spirit. Whether I said the words or not, it's what they heard and what they took with them. What I learned that day is I did not have to be perfect. I just had to be willing.
It's so powerful. And this is exactly what we feel from you. When I came first to you, this is exactly the message I received from you. Not only in words, but also in your energy, in your calmness, your compassion, your benevolence. I mean, it was really insightful and impacting. And I understand why people feel impacted by you. And then because indeed you said it, you give the courage to people with imperfection, just go. Exactly what you said, I remember when you said it to us, the people who, the women, co-authors into Step Into Your Brilliance book, and you gave us this message. When you felt, maybe they may have a little bit of, feeling a little bit nervous of sharing their story, and you sent us this message so clear, exactly as you said. Just remember, if you touch only one person, it's worth doing it. And it stayed with me and it will stay with me forever. We don't need to be perfect, and just to want to share story, if we feel the call, is because it's meaningful for someone. And also first for us, because as you said, that saying the story is also a way first to express, and it may be part of the resilience. How did you feel that for you when you shared your story for yourself?
I think for myself, there was a, because I shared my story a lot. I don't think there was any one moment the first time I shared it. Mm-hmm. It was a process for me. And it was that I could share it. And that it made a difference, that something that was negative in our family, in our family tree, in our history, in our branches, that for generations could create harm and evil. I saw the power of it. And I used to think, what if I could have a fraction of that effect for good? What if it could make a difference and heal that and move things forward? I could change the direction of growth there. And that became really meaningful. So some of that was as I reflected on what was happening and seeing lives touched. And then there was a point where I was scared about what to share and not share, when to share, and what do you share? What don't you share? And I felt held back because I was tentative about it, or almost like afraid that I would say the wrong thing. And so my story was controlling me. It was owning me. It was pinning me in. And it took some growth to be able to release that and face all of my story and choose what was being called to share so I could stand in it versus being fearful or tentative in sharing, and choose the parts to share when it makes sense versus being afraid to go to a certain place and having it own me. And that was kind of lurking in the background. So I think those were just some of the steps. And when I learned to own my story, it was part of my journey, but the past does not dictate the future, that we have choices in all of that. It actually became inspiring to me, and not that I would wish my journey on anybody, but I'm grateful for the lessons in it, the blessings in it, the incredible opportunities I've had to learn and to grow and to choose, and to have a story that can be used for good and can touch people's hearts is a gift. And I'm honored to share it.
Yeah, this is really beautiful. And this is indeed what I like so much about you and the books that you co-create with people, is that often we can find tips in the end of a chapter. So we, of course, share experiences sometimes that can be more or less positive in the meaning of a life. And then we learn how to transform it. But we allow ourselves to share our life, how we lived it, our perception of things and the facts that do belong to us. And then how we transform to give hope, inspiration to people. And I like that we can find tips always, anywhere and everywhere with you. So that is a way to say to people, hey, this is my story. And now here is the way I was able to go, or to, as you say, to have a lesson or to grow from the experience. Mm-hmm. And I have a book with me. Maybe I can share.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I love it. Yeah.
With you, which name Step Into Brilliance.
Brilliance.
Mm-hmm. That's so my first experience with you and with amazing co-authors in the book. And I understand what you say about the question, can I share it or can I not? And I really felt that writing is also an act of consciousness, that it is like... It is like a meditation. When you write first, and then after that, we think about it, and then we read it. And so we allow us, or you said, we give us permission. This is what you said earlier, to go on stage. Mm-hmm. We give us permission. And this is the power also of the storytelling. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Dalina, would you like to share with us if there are perhaps top five principles or top three principles of people who'd like to share stories, experiences, what should they have in mind?
So one, it's about connection. It's not about perfection.
Yes.
Really important. yes, really important. And I also encourage people, whether it's on stage or it's in an interview or another format that you're using to share your message, writing, to experiment a little bit, to stretch a little bit. You can even practice in the mirror if that makes you more comfortable before you're sharing it out on stage, but test your limits a bit, choose, stretch a little bit, and find the range that is right for you to share your message. So you're not limited. You're not afraid to go to one place or another. You really know where your boundaries are, where you're choosing to put them, not where it's trying to put them around you because of fear. And to have fun in sharing your message. There is great joy in sharing insight and wisdom with others and seeing that light bulb go on. So be willing to lean into that. I know we were talking a little bit before the interview, and I was sharing how one of my colleagues shares that it's really a gift to the world when we're willing to bring our message forward. So when we have learned something, we have wisdom, we have experience, it can make a difference to another. And wisdom learned and never shared is lost forever. And the world needs our wisdom. Very powerful. The world needs our insight. And we're the messengers for it. And if you're feeling that pull, you're feeling that call, it is because you are being chosen and they need it your way. And they need to hear it from you, not somebody else. So really honor that pull, honor that call to bring it forward. And every step prepares you for the next. You don't need to worry about the future so much. You don't need to worry about how many people you're touching or how this works or what is the best next step. What is the path you have today? And you have the pull and just say yes to the next step.
Yes, I like it very much. One step at a time. And then sometimes when you can say, even if you don't know the way, make the step and then the next step will show up by itself. This is exactly what we learn from you, I feel, the way you say it, because you mentioned to me earlier that, so first, it was not your first job, what you do. Your mission was somewhere else, as you said. And then you were saying to me that going to this new mission that you are sharing with us today was a kind of resistance. You mentioned this word, resistance. Mm-hmm. And so after that, so you would step into your mission, your new mission, thanks to the messages you received from your faith in God. Mm-hmm. And Rebecca, I have this question for you. I don't know if you counted, but I'm very curious to know. Because sure. Coming from one place that you were in a complete of a kind of mission, different mission, and now where you are today, have you an idea of how many interviews and how many people you guided to express themselves through different channels? Have you any idea about that?
You know, I don't, that's an interesting question. I don't know that I have a good number to share with you. I know we have been doing our radio show for over 7 years, and that's a weekly show. We have our television show that we bring forward. We have our events, our conferences, speakers that we've coached, podcast hosts we've raised up, authors that we've launched. There are hundreds and hundreds of authors we've helped bring forward as bestsellers and helping them build from that and touch people's lives. But I feel like we only get to see a fraction of the impact that we have. I, you know, when I go back to that time on stage in the heart by heart, and the line felt endless, you know, there's a ripple effect. Every time we touch a heart, every time we touch a life, every time someone's inspired to step forward, we're just part of that journey. They're the one making the ultimate choice to step forward and to shine. And then the lives they touch, it just continues. And it's, I feel like that's part of the legacy that we get to create. I hope it never ends. I hope it ends up going around the world, that one piece I got to be part of touched another life. The magazine, there's people on our email list. Every once in a while, I'll get a message saying, I've been following you for years and finally really felt led to schedule time to talk. And I'm always happy to have the conversation. I look at our numbers and we do have a promotional reach of over 10 million. It's in multiple networks and multiple countries and platforms and medias. And I'm very honored by all of that, but I think it's hard for us to know the true impact.
Yeah.
I hope that, you know, when I look back on my life, that I said yes where I was called to say yes, that I leaned in instead of shrinking back when I had that opportunity to reach out a hand and help another. And that's what I hope continues to be each step on the journey, whatever platform it ends up being on, whatever avenues or opportunities. And it can be sometimes that person in the line next to us. How are we showing up? How are we touching them? What are we echoing out? It's a way we can choose to live our life, being in alignment with who we are called to be and listening to that prompt. When you're called to reach out, even if it feels weird, even if it feels uncomfortable, say yes. It makes a difference.
This is, you're well known for this motto, I say yes. and you said yes to your purpose. And this is amazing how you can help people to say yes to their own purpose. Sometimes we don't know indeed why it can lead us. I remember the first time when I met you, I felt you were so accessible. And I didn't know exactly, you know, everything you would lead yourself and everything you created. And when we discussed and after that, you know, I discovered your mission, your purpose, your website, and I thought, oh my goodness, I spoke with you, you know, in a so normal way, so simple way, so genuine way. Mm-hmm. And then this is the lesson also I received, is that it's the most important thing is to be present in the moment. And then, so if you feel there is a calling, answer it. When I answered the call, it was a speaker talent search mm-hmm. in 2017. I had no idea what it would mean. I received an email from a friend and I saw it and I said, this is remembering me something from my childhood. So I will say yes to that. And I met you. First, you said, okay, send your bio and say yes why you want to do so. And then so I sent you the bio on an email and you know my picture. And then the second step was to send a video and explain in a few words why. It was a video. And then I said yes to the video.
Yeah, it's a stretch. I love that.
And then would be the next step. And then finally, after the next step, so it was okay. And then you gave the opportunity to be on a radio show with you. It was a few months later. And then the radio show led to two other radio shows with two other people. This is about this this effect, the ripple effect that you mentioned earlier. And then it took me 2 years to answer the call to allow myself to give you the permission to share a chapter in this book of yours, yep. Step Into Your Brilliance. Mm-hmm. And then after that, thanks to you, I know you are part of, you know, being this summit, speaking about healing the family tree, because it's worth sharing information, resources.
When we got to meet in person, which was so beautiful, with that book, and you were inspired to create the candles with the meditation. There was so much that I love that we got to connect and go deeper on as you're leaning in to being part of that book, and all that you do with our team and launches and everything. So it's powerful, and I love your mission to really bring French speaking people and English speaking people together, like creating this bridge. And that again and again has been on your heart and spirit. And I learned some of that from you in that book and on that journey.
Thanks, Rebecca. And yes, thanks to your book, you know, the book being part of it, it creates conversation. When people read the chapter, I realize we may not speak first with the family, you know, the people who may be involved into our sharing of the experience, but it does create talks and conversations with people. And I feel also it's very good to be into the sharing. Of course, there are readers that we may never meet. And there are also the people around us, and that they can also create conversations with us and ask us questions. Or we can ask them questions. How was it for you the first time you did share in a book a part of your experience?
Yeah, for me, it was scary, actually, as I go back. It was right around that same time that I was saying yes to being on stage. And it... I was just starting to find my legs and sharing my story and my message, and wasn't sure all of what that would mean in my life, and shy and an introvert. And one of the books became a a number one international bestseller, had all this visibility and exposure and media with it and videos. And I was saying yes. So I just did all the steps. So I did the conference. I did everything that was with it. And it was all a stretch for me. And I remember half my time at that conference, because we were being showcased at the conference and highlighted as co-authors, and we were signing books and all of that. I remember half the time hiding in my room, recentering, and then going back down to sign. And we wore little buttons that would say, I'm an author in the book, so people could identify us and hundreds of people that were there, so that we could then sign the books and engage with people. And I found it empowering and exciting and humbling that people were reading the chapter and then scared a little, they're reading the chapter, you know, it was mixed, but that it impacted them so much that they wanted to talk, that they wanted to have my signature, my energy in their book. So it was deeply humbling, deeply honoring, very stretching. And I have done it again and again and again. And it's such an honor to be able to impact people in that way, one chapter at a time.
Wow, thank you. Thank you to share that.
Excuse me, yes.
Thanks, Rebecca. Yeah, is there something, you know, because you share about one chapter at a time, mm-hmm. and connecting with people, and actually with this specific time of the world, right, we are more at home. We have sometimes a lockdown. In France, mm-hmm. we had two lockdown periods, and I know you did also have in America. And so do you feel that there is an impact on people reading books, or people wanting to write books or to write chapters? Is there any impact you can measure?
Yeah, I've actually seen an increase in people writing, reading. Excuse me, I'm having a little bit of allergies today. What I have found is people have wanted to go deeper. Some have slowed down a little bit. They're asking questions. They're looking at, if not now, when? When they're making some of those, someday I'm going to.
Yes.
To today. And it's created a sense of urgency. So I found people became more committed for projects they had been playing with or working on for years. Suddenly it became very important to bring those forward, to make a difference, to have a positive voice in a challenging time around the world. And that became a fire in their belly, so to speak, something that encouraged them to lean in and bring it forward. And I found sometimes, for me, especially in the beginning, a full book felt daunting. Like, where do you start on a full book? Mm-hmm. I have to write a whole book on my own. But if I could instead write a chapter, that's 1500 to 2500 words, 3000 words. I can do that.
Exactly.
And that's much more approachable, I found, for people. So anthologies are compilation books. They're books where multiple authors come together under a common theme, like Step Into Your Brilliance. And you each write one chapter from your perspective, your area of expertise. And it's beautiful how all the energies get woven together by the people called to be part of that conversation, part of that book. And it's such a rich experience for the reader, because each person has a different energy, a different vibration, a different area of expertise, and they're getting that whole collection of support in one book.
Exactly. Isn't it amazing? And I was myself very surprised, because when we made this anthology, Step Into Your Brilliance, we had the title, when we knew it would be other co-authors, we didn't know each other so much in the very beginning.
Yeah.
Of course, step by step. And the magic has been happening. I mean, there is a secret sauce of yours that when we finally discover the book and the result of it, and we see even the names of the titles, and so there is an energy behind the book. You said you used the word the signature. It may be an energetic signature behind a book, and you are you have this magic to create the secret sauce of yours that makes people feeling, you know, the glue together. We have a title. And then after that, this is magic of being all connected, all related, and the purpose being to share, express, and inspire by getting inspired and being guided, I would say, led, but also guided by you and your experience. It was really an experience that was life-changing, and I wish for the people who do listen to us today, who feel the calling for writing, that they may allow themselves or they may give themselves permission to also experience such things.
Absolutely. And it's, you know, I would say some of that signature magic, as you call it, or secret sauce, is I really feel into a book that's being called forth, being birthed. Like I try to tap into that next step. What am I called to bring forward? And I help the authors do the same. I look for authors that are called to be part of it, not just, oh, it's a book and I want to write, but they're actually called to be part of it. And that's what creates the magic, because it's a calling on both sides and it's meant to come together and create something that hasn't been created before and touch lives that are calling for it. So that's the energy that weaves it together that brings it forward. And every co-author we always talk with, we always make sure they are feeling the call, why they want to be in it, why they're called to be part of it, so that we can bring something really powerful forward for the author as well as the reader.
Yes, indeed. And you are leading several styles of books. There are books that may talk to people who like to find a purpose or read, kind of, it's like reading a book, as you said, sometimes it's like reading a book and reading stories of the people. You do have also books that do speak to experts, from experts to experts, or from experts to people who tend to develop as experts, and some people who do not know that they are experts, but they can feel through the books that they are. And you do also have indeed anthologies speaking about animals, animal legacy. I love that one. You do also have grandma legacy, right? Yes. So many books that you lead and you guide people to express their own story and their own experience through several topics that can talk to large audiences. And then people can really find their way how to share their experience of writing via all these topics. And this is what I love also about you. You are able to be from experts into the most professional side to speaking about animals' legacy, which is also very important, specifically actually that we need to find connections, not only by digital world, but also in the physical world, right?
Exactly. Well, I think it's important we have that range. And part of the mission of that book, The Animal Legacies, was to remind people of how important and powerful those connections are, and to really pay attention to the animals that are showing up in our lives, that are connecting with us, and the relationships and information that are formed, and the deep richness in those animal beings that are in our lives, and what a gift they are. And I think sometimes we get distracted, or we can forget the connection, the wisdom, the love that is there, and that we also can give and share and open our hearts to. And the grandmother legacies, that was a really, really neat book. We had three generations writing in that book, which I loved. So we had granddaughters, we had mothers, and we had grandmothers that were writing their own legacy of the message they were bringing forward and sharing. So I loved the range, the business books. What is common about all, we have journals, all the types of books we bring forward, they are positive and transformational. They're designed to be interactive with the reader and to support them on their journey. and bring them information, insight, resources that can help them.
Indeed, that's, thank you to share that with us. And we know that we can find all of your books on the, so you have a website, you have several websites. Rebecca, would you like to share with us, do you have, you know, hot points that will happen into your world for the next weeks, perhaps, or months? Would you like to share with us what is happening from your side?
Okay, sure. So, coming up, we are doing the speaker talent search right now, which is how we met. So very excited about that. So people who want to learn more, who are interested in bringing their message forward, they can go to speakertalentsearch.com, see all the details there. But it allows people to stretch a bit, to get clarity on their message. Those who are very clear on their message, to be able to get in front of people who are actually looking for speakers and experts to have on their stages, to interview on their shows. So it's a great opportunity. And it's part of our giving back to the world, where we're able to help messengers connect with opportunities. And that's what the Speaker Talent Search is about. So I encourage everyone to check it out and see if there's a pull, see if there's a call. Let's see, what else are we? We're part of this powerful summit that we are sharing now. So we're excited about that. There are several anthology projects that we have in the works that we are looking at bringing forward, and there are opportunities to participate in them or to just mark the date on your calendar and watch for them to be released. The magazine we release on a bi-monthly basis, so we like to share that out. We recently started a podcast show called The Author's Journey. We started that in October. Of 2020. And what it's about is really pulling back the curtain of what it's like to write a journey, to write a book, to write a chapter, to have it become bestseller, to just go on that whole journey. What is that like? What have they learned? What surprised them? And I love what the people being interviewed shared. I never quite know what they're going to share. So I get to hear and experience it with them and see. So I love that we have that. We've brought that forward. And for any authors out there, I encourage you to check it out, The Author's Journey. And I think it'll encourage you and give you some great tips. And you may relate to a lot of the authors and what they thought and felt before, and what helped them actually decide to bring it forward, not have it just be someday I'm going to do this, I have a book in me, but really this is the day I'm bringing it forward. And they share about that.
Yeah, that's the power of your team, of you also, because then when you start to step into the process, so there is one way, is to succeed.
Yes. And
this is the best thing. It is to succeed, and the success is measured by the pleasure we do have to collaborate with you and to collaborate as co-authors. So this is the most measurable thing, and we see on the social medias how people do enjoy to share, you know, with you and with the people and with their communities all the new books. And this is these are resources. This is feed for the soul, for the mind, for the spirit. And so I know that people will connect with you via the social medias, because we do have a special page for you on the website also, of Healing the Family Tree. And then people can see where to reach you on Facebook, on YouTube, on in Instagram, indeed,
yep,
on LinkedIn,
yep,
on your websites. And Rebecca, it's such an honor and a joy to be with you today. Thank you that you share so powerfully your message and your purpose. And I just wish that many people can also have the joy to feel what it is to experience connection with you and an experience with your team. And I can just wish for you, you know, the best for continuation of a mission. Thank you.
Thank you so much. It's been an honor and a pleasure, and I look forward to each interview that you're bringing forward. I'm excited to be part of this, and you've just lined up such an amazing group of leaders and experts that I'm looking forward to enjoying the summit as well as participating in it. So beautiful. Thank you for having me.
Thank you, Rebecca, and see you soon.